show me the front door?
Oh, doll, I'd love to, but I'm actually super busy with important humanitarian work.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us tonight, and welcome to 8-Bit Bytes. I know that some of you are coming back from previous episodes, and some of you might be new. Thanks to everybody for showing up to see us making some Dagger Quill Rice tonight. Dagger Quill Rice is from Final Fantasy XV, which is a fantastic, well, not new at this point, but newer Final Fantasy game that has so much food in it, and it's actually one of the things that made me want to start doing this stream in the first place. Unlike some of the other things that I've done, like I was talking about Breath of the Wild in one of our previous episodes, the food isn't completely integral to the game, but it is a really fun sort of side questy type of thing. There are specific side quests that deal with getting, you know, certain food items and things like that. My outfit today, while not exactly accurate, is inspired by the cook of the group in Final Fantasy XV, which is Ignis. He's a very kind of upstanding gentleman with interesting fashion taste. He's kind of got like a rock and roll vibe and glasses, which of course these are fake. I did have a wig on too, but then I decided to take that off. But if I had kept that on, I looked a lot like my mom with these glasses on. But anyway, so there's a couple parts to this meal, but it's actually one of the simpler things that we will be cooking on this show, because it's just a chicken and rice dish. Anytime that you're doing chicken and rice, it's gonna be, you know, something you can just kind of throw together last minute, not a lot of prep. And instead of just using a normal white rice, we're going to still use white rice, but we're gonna jazz it up a little bit, I guess. So we'll see how that goes. Okay, so first off, the chicken's gonna be the last thing that we take care of. I already have it trimmed up and cleaned and all ready to go in the pan. But first we need to get our rice going because that's gonna take about 20 minutes to cook, just like rice tends to do. So first, before I get the broth boiling, because we're gonna do it with broth instead of water just to add a little bit of extra flavor. Of course, if you are looking out for your sodium intake, you can always get low sodium broth or something like that, because it is going to add a little bit of salt versus just having water in there. You also need to keep in mind that due to how the rice takes in the liquid, the broth does evaporate quicker due to the salt content. So you need a little more broth than you would be using if you were using water. A lot of times I eyeball it, but a good ratio is like 2 cups of broth to 1 cup of rice, and that usually turns out pretty good. So we're going to go ahead and make our spice mixture. So we'll just go ahead and take this little bowl here. You always need little bowls. I look like a chef today. Yeah, I should have borrowed my daughter's chef hat. She has a chef hat in her room. Let's see, okay. So for this, I don't want to use too much spice. We just want the rice to be lightly seasoned. How I'm going to get an eighth of a teaspoon out of here, I don't know. We'll go ahead and dig around in there. There we go. So a little tiny bit of salt. Eighth of a teaspoon of salt. We're going to do an eighth of a teaspoon of thyme. I don't know if I have that much left. We're out of time. I should have bought more. Okay, but you know, once in a while you end up accidentally running out of the seasoning, so we'll just not put the thyme in, which is fine. But we do need an eighth of a teaspoon of ground ginger. Now, for everybody who watches this, you'll probably notice I like to use a lot of seasonings. Oops, we do not want an eighth of a teaspoon of cayenne. We're just going to do a dash of cayenne to add a little bit of heat. Just a little bit. Oh, hey, more people joining us here. Even if you can only watch for a few minutes, thank you so much for coming in. The thought that counts. We got eighth of a teaspoon of paprika. If you want to get fancy, you can get some of that Hungarian smoked paprika stuff. I use a lot of the spice classics. They're like 99 cents, and honestly, that's not that big of a deal to get the fancy spices. And what else? Let me look at the list. Okay, so yeah, like I said, we ran out of time. No time. So let me skip that. The thyme would just give it kind of a, you know, fresher taste, but not a big deal. And honestly, when you're doing a seasoned rice like this, when you're making up your own seasonings, you can put a little bit of whatever you personally like in there. If you wanted to have, you know, some chili powder or something like that, that'd be good too. I could use basil. I do have basil. I don't think I'm gonna use basil because the basil that I have is the chunkier dried flakes, and that would give it kind of a weird texture. So I think we're just gonna go ahead and skip that for now. But, so we have that, and I'm gonna give just a dash of cayenne. That's probably more than a dash, but I like cayenne, so. And when we do the red pepper sauce that goes with this, it's kind of up to you whether you want to make it have heat to it, because we're going to be using sweet bell peppers that are roasted, so that is not inherently hot. Obviously red things doesn't mean hot, Okay, so we have our little tiny spice mix, which I probably didn't have to put in this bowl, but that's okay. So I'm gonna go over here to the stove, and I'm just gonna shake this up a little bit so it gets mixed together. And with the way the camera's set up, I don't know if you'll be able to see.
Can't see over there.
Okay, well, I'm gonna move this pan for a minute.
Just so you can show.
Just to show you guys my kind of crusty pan. So we're gonna do 2 cups of chicken stock, chicken broth. Doesn't have to be stock, really, it's the same thing. And we're going to do 2 cups of rice. So I actually like to bring that together at the same time instead of pre-boiling. That's the way I do it. Certain recipes call for, you know, bring it to a boil first, but so, and we'll go ahead and dump that spice mixture in there. So it's all kind of blended in together. Something is proving to be a little chunky. I think it was the ginger. I don't know why. So that is, for this particular dish, a lot better than just straight up plain white rice. And then to make it better slash worse for you, we want to put just a tablespoon of butter in there, because that's going to help get all of the grains of rice coated. So we're gonna go ahead and turn that on to high, and I'll put my chicken pan back over here. So we'll get that stuff out of the way, and then I just gotta keep an eye on that to make sure it doesn't boil over or anything like that. Again, we've had issues you've seen before with the heat on our stove. It tends to fluctuate extremely, so it's either very hot or not on. So I have to make sure that that rice doesn't go boiling over, and it probably will. So we'll see how that goes. Okay, so the next thing we're gonna do, again, like I said, this is really a pretty quick meal to make. Once the rice comes to a boil, we'll put that on for 20 minutes, and that should really be all the time that this entire meal takes to cook. It might take more because I'm showing you how to do stuff, but we'll see. So for the chicken's gonna be the last thing I just double guessed myself. We'll do the chicken after I get the sauce started, because the sauce will need some time to reduce, but the chicken's gonna take much longer to cook than the sauce takes to reduce. And we don't want raw chicken, which I know I say like every single time. But to start the sauce, I had to break out my food processor, which I haven't used in forever. So we'll see how that goes, and it should work. And if it doesn't work, I don't know what I'm gonna do. But I mean, I'm just being honest. I have it plugged in over here. Yeah, the idea of putting the basil or any like chunkier herb into something like a magic bullet would be great. It's a great idea. In my food processor, obviously the blade's a little big, so it will take care of our peppers. I've been thinking about getting something like a spice grinder, which would be very helpful for fresh spices and things like that. So I know in my recipe I have it written down that you need a jar of peppers. Now that's not a great descriptor, because a jar of peppers could mean a lot of things. So what I have is, I got a 16-ounce jar of roasted red peppers, which you can find in like the antipasto section of the grocery store, where you have like olives, pickles, and all that type of stuff. So that's all in there, because a lot of people like to put these things on subs, sandwiches, things like that. I've never actually used anything like this before, so we'll see how it goes. But all in all, this jar costs like $2.50, which, if you're going to be buying fresh peppers, you're probably going to be paying about that much anyway. And this way you don't have to worry about finding a way to fire roast your peppers. peppers and then dunk them in ice water and take the skins off and take all the stuff out of the inside. It just saves a ton of time. So I'm gonna give my food processor a try, and before I put anything in there, let's see.
You wanna check on the rice boil first?
I will check on the rice boil. It's starting to go a little bit. Thank you for reminding me though.
Yeah.
So I'll give that a little stir, and it's still just starting to come up. That just needs another minute. So before I put anything in there, how's this look? Can you see this with this camera?
Yeah.
Okay.
A little farther forward.
A little farther forward. Okay, but so I'll kind of have it on the side like this, then you'll be able to see what's going in there. Let's see if it works. Yep, works. So apparently chop and grind on this thing just changes the direction that the blade is spinning in. I don't know. Like I said, I don't use this very much. So, we're going to go ahead and...
we're going to drop the volume on the microphone.
Oh, yeah, we'll drop the volume. How much did you drop the volume? Can they still...
No, you can talk.
Oh, okay.
Just don't talk while it's running, because I'm going to drop the volume.
So, we're going to go ahead and use this entire jar of peppers.
Mm-mm-mm.
It really smells good, actually. It smells like peppers. So these are whole roasted red peppers, and it's probably going to end up being a lot more... See, I don't want to just pour it in, though, because I don't want all of that juice. The juice from them would be... It's on the salty side, so we're going to use a little bit of it, but not all of it.
They got a nice color.
Yeah, they're really nice. You can see they still have a little bit of the char on them, which is fine. You don't need to, like, dig that out or anything. And I'm just splashing peppers everywhere. But these look really nice. And I'm hoping...
Rice.
Oh, yes, rice. Thank you.
Yeah,
so we got that rice going. We're going to turn it way down low. You want it to be at a simmer. And just to not go crazy there, we'll put our timer on for 20 minutes. Like I said, by the time that's done, this will probably be all done. But we'll see. If rice takes, if it has to sit to the side for a few minutes, that's not a big deal. So let's get all of those peppers out, and you can see it's a lot of peppers. To help mix this up a little bit, we're going to put just a little bit of this pepper juice in here, like that. And now I'm going to hope for the best and put this top on. So
yeah,
I'm going to be quiet for a minute. It's not like super smooth, but it's pretty pureed. I'm not seeing any chunks. And honestly, I don't mind the sauce being a little on the chunkier side anyway. So to this, we're going to add some garlic. Actually, wait. It would give it better flavor if I added the garlic after I get it in the pan, so we're not going to add the garlic to this. We're just going to take this off of here, and maybe I should put the lid back on. Okay. Yeah, we have pink hair crew in here, because Bex there also has some pink hair. Who doesn't love pink hair? Okay, so, sauce-wise, we're talking this puree and some of my favorite pre-minced garlic. Gonna do a little bit of cayenne, and then I was also going to add some cardamom, which is over there. Okay, I can put that rice back on the direct heat now. It's not going crazy. Tiny bit of cardamom. So, but before we go ahead and do this, we are going to start our chicken. So I'm going to get the pan heated up and get this stuff out of my way. I have my trash bowl here, but there's nothing to go in it today because there just isn't. This doesn't have any vegetable component besides the cucumbers that are a garnish. Like I said before, adding green vegetables to any of these meals that don't happen to include them, please do that. Or just have rice. Just have a giant bowl of rice. That's fine too. I'm not your mom. I'm not going to tell you how to eat.
I'm not a cop.
I'm not a cop. I'm not your mom. Eat what you want, honestly. Okay. So, we're going to get this pan over here. I'm going to break out my olive oil. The rice is going at a nice casual simmer, which is where we want it. Yes. I was going to say, yeah. Now, you said that you were going to not be responding to the chat, but now you are responding to the chat. That's fine. Obviously, I'm not the one typing. And I won't be the one typing because I'm about to have chicken hands. Yeah, I like cardamom a lot. I like a lot of those, like, Middle Eastern spices. I mean, a lot of spices come from that area of the world. And they're all delicious, so I want to put them in everything. I work with a couple of main flavor profiles when I'm cooking, and I'm honestly not really sure what one this is falling into, because I like to do a lot of like Mexican style food, and I do a lot of different types of Asian food, Japanese, Chinese, and I started dabbling in Korean food, which is a lot of fun. Those are very different spice sets. I need to work more with like lemongrass and stuff like that. So, yes, I'm gonna wait for this pan to heat up, and then I have my chicken all taken care of over here, because it's easier to just kind of take care of your chicken when you get home from grocery shopping. I think it's funny how natural it feels to wear glasses when I don't actually wear glasses. I just like the feel of them on my nose. I'm sure I'll need glasses one day. My vision will start going, but I've been pretty good so far, pretty lucky. I'm gonna say, you have glasses, both my parents have glasses, like everybody, most of my family has glasses. I think my sister's supposed to have glasses, but she doesn't wear them.
She has like reading glasses.
She has reading glasses, yeah. Okay, so, yeah, like I said, I like to, when I have the time, getting home from the grocery store, just pre-portioning my meat and taking the fat off of it and stuff like that. If I have like a big pack of chicken and then putting it into baggies, it's just easier for doing stuff during the week. Saves you a little bit of time later. So, actually, if I don't want to get meat hands, I could even use my tongs to get this chicken out of the bag. We'll go ahead and give this just a little bit of olive oil, not too much. Because, again, I use nonstick pans. I really like things like cast iron. But, again, for, like, weeknight cooking. Oh, right. Well, here. This isn't a big deal. What we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and toss these in the pan. And then I'll give them a little bit of a sprinkle of salt and pepper. That one had some juice on it. Now I'm going to go ahead and get those flat. I know that I said in my recipe that we were just going to be doing two chicken breasts, but since I wanted to make sure that Dan will have lunch tomorrow, I'm doing three chicken breasts. The amount of rice is the same. It really doesn't matter. Yeah, computer. If I end up needing anything in the long run, it's probably going to be computer glasses, because I'm on the computer a lot. So So we're going to give these a little bit of salt. Thank you for throwing that away from me. Little bit of pepper. And you'll see I'm using boneless, skinless, because that's what I like to work with most of the time. I'm not always going to be using those. Because really, those can just sit for a minute while I talk to you. This recipe is kind of a take on, I mean, not my version of it, but the actual recipe in the game, the dagger quill rice or the bird broth rice, depending on how you're making it or if you're getting it in a restaurant in the game, is coming from, I believe it's a Taiwanese dish, which is a chicken and rice, and it looks very simple, but it's not. It has a ton of flavor. From beginning to end, you are gonna, you know, take a whole chicken, you're gonna use the bones to make the broth, you're gonna be throwing a ton of, like, lemongrass and all of those amazing Taiwanese flavors in there. I don't believe it has any spice to it. Again, I like to make everything spicy, that's my choice. But, again, obviously, if you're making this and you don't want it to be spicy, leave the spice out. Just that simple. You know, and again, I think I talked about the difference between hot spice, like cayenne, and spice, like...
You set a timer for the rice?
Yeah, that is the timer for the rice. So we're on 11 minutes for the rice now, and it's coming along just fine. One of those things where you get a feel for how your stove works. Having worked with a couple of different stove tops, it makes a world of difference whether you're using electric heat or a gas burner stove, which has a lot more control. On this one, for instance, you're gonna make sure, you'll see that I check the chicken a lot. And I check it even more when I'm not on camera because I'm facing the chicken the whole time. But, what I like to do personally, especially with something like this, is I'm looking to get it a nice brown, golden brown on one side, and then I flip it and I give it another, like, I'll probably give this on one side, 8 to 10 minutes. And then flip it, even though I keep checking it. You'll see here, this is starting to get brown, but I don't want to actually flip these to the other side yet, because you can see the heat coming up through the chicken, and you can kind of see where it's white along the edge, and you need that to get approximately to the middle. I know that's not a great way of explaining that, but long story short, you wanna make sure your chicken's cooked. Chicken is one of those things where it always takes longer than you think it's gonna take, especially if you're, that's again why I work a lot with the boneless, skinless, because that takes the least cooking time unless you're working with certain cuts of dark meat. But if you have something that has skin on or bones, it takes much more time because it's going to take so much longer around the bones to cook, and it might look done, and then you get in and around the bone it's still raw, which you don't want to have to deal with, especially once you cut into the chicken. It's kind of like, I've put cut chicken back in a pan, I'm not gonna lie, but you don't really want to have to do that. So, at least it's not as bad as cutting into like a steak and putting it back in a pan. So, doing pretty good. And then, I don't like to let it cook too dry, so this is probably going to fizzle up a little bit, just to give some fair warning, but Ashley will turn this heat back a tad, and then I like to give it a little bit of broth. I find that that helps it cook a little more evenly. We have some more followers. Oh, some salt sauce. Oh, it's just, oh, that's my sister. I forgot that that was your name. The broth is just the same chicken broth that I am using for the rice. I always buy it in these little boxes like this, because it's super convenient and it has this flip lid, so you can use as much as you need and put it in the fridge. And I just use store brand broth because it doesn't matter, and it's really all about what you're putting in. I haven't found any real taste difference, in my opinion. It says 99% fat free, for whatever that's worth. Oh, why is it the broth in the pan? Because it helps with locking in some of the moisture for the chicken as it is cooking. It's steaming it just a little bit. So ultimately, when I'm getting the sides browned, then I don't need to add more broth right now, even though I just kind of freaked out when I looked at the pan, but once both sides are browned enough, in my opinion, which I'm going to help that along in just a second, because I want to press these down to make sure that they're cooking evenly, which is also a very important thing when it comes to cooking chicken. So, again, I get out my trusty foil wrap here. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put this down. And I forgot to plug my computer in looking at you guys, so hopefully I won't lose the chat here. I'm going to get this super fun... Okay, so you're not going to be able to see anything because I'm putting this foil over here. But I have this panini press thing, which is super old school, and I don't know where I got it from. The other two chicken breasts are pretty evenly proportioned, but I'm going to go ahead and really press down on that one in the middle, and putting a weight on the chicken like that, and obviously I put the foil because that iron thing is very old, and it's been sitting around. I don't want to get dust on the chicken, that's gross. So we're going to press the chicken down, and I'm listening to the sizzling, and I can hear that, you know, it might sound like it's pressing the juices out, but it's not. It's searing the outside of the meat, so that will keep all of that juiciness inside. And then again, like I already said, once that's browned on both sides, I cook it for a little longer with a little bit of the broth and just a tiny bit of butter. Getting distracted by the chat. But so then I put the lid on to finish cooking it off. I found that's the best way to... It feels like it takes longer when you're just doing it in the pan with the lid off. But so I'll kind of keep an eye on that. I'm going to check the rice real quick and see how that's doing. The rice is, it's got a few minutes on it, and it's looking pretty good, but still got a bit of liquid in there. So, I'll adjust the temperature just a little bit. And then...
Hi,
Rachel has a question. How many times, if any, do you cook these recipes before making them?
This one I've cooked twice, maybe, I think. Because it was, when I saw it, I really wanted to try it, like, right away, even before we start doing this. So you'll see, now there's really some browning going on there. So now I'm going, but insofar as, I actually haven't made the pepper sauce for this before, I've just made the chicken and the rice. So, the pepper sauce will be a new experiment. We're going to turn the heat back a little bit. Give it another dousing of broth and just a teeny bit of butter on top of each of the breasts is actually how I prefer to do it. You'll see it falls off. But that way I can just portion out a little bit and it helps keep it moist and I'm steaming my hands, but that's all right. And then I'm gonna go ahead and find where I've, oh, there's the lid. And find the lid. I'm gonna give these a little swirl to help loosen up some of that there. I'm gonna put the lid on. I'm gonna turn it back. And turn it back more than I want to, really, because the stove's doing that thing it does where it gets really hot. So again, in a minute, I'm probably gonna have to add more broth because of the heat of the stove. But yeah, so ideally, I would like to try cooking all of these recipes fully through at least once before I do them, but due to the nature of having to get all of the ingredients and having the time and ending up making like the same dinner several times in a number of weeks, I try not to do that because usually I like to try to mix up our dinner schedule. You know, I don't do like Taco Tuesday or anything like that. I do tacos whenever I want, but I try not to do things consecutively. But yeah, so again, you can see my stove here. Oh, and the rice says it's done. We'll check that in a second. I'm gonna give this pan a little spin actually to get that heat a bit better distributed. And get that back on there. So I'll check the rice again. That's good. And we can just have this off the heat and sitting over to the side for right now. I'll turn the heat off on that. And then the last thing that we're going to need to do once the chicken is done is to get this pepper sauce going. But I want to make sure I use the same burner so you guys can see how that's made. It's not that big of a deal, but you know, little things.
So I've just kind of been keeping an eye on how much time the chicken is going for. But I'm a very impatient person. It's very important to be patient when you're a cook. I can tell that this one's going to take longer to cook because it is much bigger than the other two. So we're going to leave that and adjust the heat again because my stove is complicated. While we're doing that, I will go ahead and I'm going to make a drink. This week's drink, I'm not doing an alcoholic drink this time because I don't feel like drinking alcohol. I'm tired. And it's going to knock me right out. And after that, I'm still feeling the shock from last week. So no more vodka right now. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm just going to make a mana potion. I was going to say, if you could grab me the ginger ale out of the fridge, because
You're sitting in front of the fridge. Are we out of ginger ale? Mm-hmm. Oops. Well, let's see. What can we work with then? Hand me something. I'll work on the fly. All right. I guess we are doing alcohol then. Because I have a bottle of tiny leftover.
Champagne.
From New Year's, because since we knew we weren't going to be going out or anything, because we are old people.
We are quite old.
Oh, it's not that we're old, we're just homebodies, so. Plus, every, yay. No.
We say champagne. Yeah, because it's from two trauma.
He's French Canadian, so. So, I don't want to hit myself in the face with this. I should probably get a glass out, though. And, you know what? I don't want to ruin champagne by putting other stuff into it, so I guess we're just going to drink champagne.
Oh, you can make a drink with it. We're the dreamers of dreams and the singers of songs here.
Okay, well, we're going to put some blue into... some blue. Here, just in this little majig here. And I'll move my sauce off to the side. Yeah, we don't have any mint though. We have champagne and we have apple juice. Since we have 4-year-old, I don't know if that would really taste very good. So I'm not sure about how this particular bottle opens and I'm afraid of it, so I'm gonna hand it off. I get scared by things like opening champagne bottles and tubes of Pillsbury dough that just scares the crap out of me. So, is it just a little like, oh. It wasn't a cork. It looks like a cork and it was fake.
Here.
Alrighty. Yeah, it wasn't a cork. It was a fake cork. It's just a little twist off. Alright. Oh, that was really silly. Yes! No. What Insult Salt said, I hate popping balloons. My daughter tries to scare me by popping balloons and threatening to pop balloons. I know, I don't, it freaks me out. And I know some people are like really into it. Before I do this, let me check the chicken. That smells really good.
In the recipe in the game, the chicken's very pale looking, because in the Taiwanese style of doing this dish, you boil the chicken, you don't saute it. But I didn't want to just do the boiled chicken, and plus that would be something. What did you ask? What was the question?
I think she was asking where Gambit was in Canada, from Canada.
Yes, that question wasn't pointed at me. Okay, so we're just gonna, just a little bit of the blue. The blue is the cocktail mix, so this doesn't actually have any alcohol in it. It's just blue raspberry mix, which tastes good, so we're gonna have a blue raspberry sparkly vapor potion. How's that look there?
Yeah, it's good.
Okay. So, a little bit of that action, and I'll spill it on my cutting board. And I probably poured more blue too, but let's see how it goes. How blue are you? More blue. Sure, why not? It's fizzy. It's a drink. Looks like a man potion. It's blue. Oh no, how does that look in this light? This cup is very faceted. This random pretty cup I have. I was gonna put it in a bottle, but the bottle had like old flowers in it and I rinsed it out, but I wasn't gonna want to drink out of there, so. Tastes like blue champagne, what's up? Yeah, these little champagne bottles that hold like to, you know,
like two glasses of champagne. Okay, so
little mixology trick: if you want to make it darker, you add something like the grenadine, which will make it really dark, and then add the blue afterwards, and it makes it a
yeah.
color.
So I'm giving this chicken a poke, and it's feeling like it's getting towards being cooked. That's one of those tricks you kind of learn when you're working in the food industry, if you're dealing with meat.
Remember, there's two mics, so either face the stove or face the...
Sorry! But yeah, you kind of learn this trick where you know when you press on it how much give it has. That's especially true of red meat. But I think we can go ahead, and I'm going to actually leave the chicken in the pan for right now to just hang out. And of course it's going to yell at me because there's water over there. But so we're going to take our new pan, and we're going to take our garlic, and just a teeny bit of butter. And I will find my spoon. There it is. So, what did I say? How much? Tablespoon of minced garlic. Okay. Gonna be garlicky.
But we've talked about this before. We use a pot garlic. Okay, so, go in there.
And let's find a spoon. So the main reason that I'm adding this to the pan first is because I want to get a little bit of a cook on the minced garlic before I put it into the sauce. Otherwise, I would have just put the garlic directly in the sauce. But this way, it'll brown a little and bring out a little bit more of that flavor.
You can get out that sweet garlic oil
that
going
sweet,
to the sauce.
Yes, that sweet garlic oil. I've lost track of my drink.
This drink?
Yes, that drink. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you to Dan for fixing the audio. Like he said, we now have two microphones. So if I'm standing this way, there's one microphone. If I'm standing that way, there's another microphone. Because honestly, I'm not that good at projecting. Like, even speaking like this, I feel like I'm yelling. I'm a fairly quiet person. So,
get this garlic. I know I've discussed this with several of you, the fact that talking just kind of at my food and at the camera is a lot easier than talking to people, because I'm not a people person, but you're on the other side of the computer, so that makes it a lot easier. Okay, so this is starting to sizzle a little bit, so let's come and get the pan up to heat there. I probably should have waited to put it in, but whatever. Pop the lid back on the garlic jar. And then, how much cardamom did we want to put in there?
It says a half teaspoon.
Yeah, I do, I do spill stuff a lot to have a look. I can't. I get stuff all over myself.
I don't know that I'm necessarily going to measure that out. I might
just give it a couple of dashes. But so, garlic is good. good. So I don't want to cook it much more than that. Otherwise, we're going to run into it potentially burning. So I'm going to put the top of my food processor over there, and then I'm going to gingerly pour all of this out. Like that. And try not to make a mess. So, that looks pretty nice. And, you know, it looks like a lot of garlic, but considering the amount of pepper that's in there, not too much. It'll just be a hint of garlic. Like I said, this could, you know, be blended down more? Yeah.
That's a really nice color.
It is. It's a super nice color. By doing, you know, again, this is something you could do yourself if you really wanted to, if you have a bunch of peppers laying around or something. But, by doing the roasting, and then I know to get the skins off of roasted peppers, you have to dunk them in ice water and then get all of that black, crispy, charred skin off, and you're just left with the really nice, soft, fleshy bits, all the red fleshy bits on the inside. Now that makes it sound really appetizing. So, I'll go ahead and I'll put my cardamom in here. Grab my measuring spoons back. Where's my eighth? There it is. So as I've said before, the cardamom, it's just going to give it a little bit of like a sweet spice, which will go nice with the peppers because they're already sweet. I've been wanting to actually try a red pepper sauce like this on some pasta, or doing it on pizza in place of a regular marinara, because I think that would be delicious. And this is the eighth of cayenne. Yeah, that'll be fine. I don't want to make it too spicy. I want it to blend well with the rice. So, let's see, it's starting to kind of do its thing. And then, ultimately, what we're going for here is that we're going to be cooking some of that extra liquid out of this sauce. And everything else is done. So, we'll just turn the heat up a little bit on that. And we'll be reducing this a bit. Not too much, because it didn't get as liquidy as I would have expected. If you want it to be a really nice, smooth puree, then by all means, once this sauce is all together and hot like this, you can put it right back in your food processor or your blender. Just be careful not to burn yourself. And you can do that. This would also be a really great base for a sauce. Oh, and that's, I almost forgot. This isn't the sauce by itself. We are adding a half cup. Yes, ginger went in with the rice. We're adding a half a cup of heavy cream. So that's gonna turn this from a puree into a sauce. I don't often do a lot of cream sauces, but I have been starting to try more. And obviously now it's going from that bright red to a kind of creamy, orangey, starting to look like a tikka masala sauce. And now from here, we're going to want to reduce it. So that will take a couple minutes. While we're waiting for that to reduce, I'm going to take my chicken out and I'm going to give it a little cut and test it just to make sure. So I'll use my, I don't want to get chicken juice on my wooden cutting board. Of course, we go back, give it a stir when it needs a stir, get that going. these chickens off of here. And, you know, they're nice and sealed,
so I'm not worried about any juice dripping. I say as two drops of juice drip onto my board.
That was from the pan.
Oh, was
that's what we're going to call it.
Pan juice. So, this is coming up now like this.
And, so we're going to keep it around a medium heat. And as it reduces, obviously, it's going to go back from that pale orange more towards the red. That a little bit. I don't really want this popping all over the place. Not only because I don't feel like being covered in scalding hot pepper sauce, but also because I don't want it on the camera or really on the stove. It can just chill. Okay, so when with this chicken,
you're gonna need to for presentation, cut it anyway. So I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna give it, it's quite hot, but I touch it with my fingers, it's alright. You see the chicken? Don't make that face at me. Can you see the chicken alright here? Okay, so we're gonna give it, it's too, I lied, it's too hot for me to do that, I need a fork.
See, you tried to tough it out.
I flew too close to the sun.
And you got burned.
I literally got burned.
Yeah,
yes.
You literally got burned.
Okay.
Oh, I splattered my sauce.
It's okay.
But yeah, okay. So
let's try this again with a fork because I don't know my own endurance. So that is nicely cooked through.
It's like perfect.
So, I don't want to plate this yet because the sauce is going to be going under the rice. So, that sauce just needs a minute. It's really bubbling away right now. But I'm going to go ahead and cut because it had a few minutes to sit in the pan. If I was able to keep everything in line here.
The lines.
Yeah, that's really what you want to get is the nice lines. But I'm being a little sloppy with this cut here. But yeah, that looks absolutely perfect.
Do you want to hold the last piece up to the camera so people can see it?
Broken. So yeah, so you can see, you know, fully cooked through, still juicy. But it's not leaking everywhere. All the juice is nice trapped in that chicken because we got that good sear on it. And it would look a lot nicer if I was able to cut it in a way where it wasn't crumbling under my fork, but that's all right. So.
So we're getting a good reduction going on that sauce.
Yeah, the sauce is coming around, and honestly, I don't think we need to let it reduce any more than this because we want it to be not soupy, but it's we don't want it to be too tacky under the rice either because this is going to be like something you want to scoop up with the rice. So I think that's probably going to be pretty good. Would I like to have made this smoother? Maybe, but I don't, you know. I'm not that much of a perfectionist when it comes to my food, because I figure if it tastes good, that's the most important thing. So I'm going to get out a couple of bowls. I still need to invest in those,
the Coleman camping plates that they use in Final Fantasy XV, because I find those absolutely hilarious. So, I'll just put together the one bowl for right now. You don't have to see both of our dinner portions. Not important. So again, we have this sauce here. It's a lot of sauce, considering how much rice and chicken we have. But, you know, I guarantee that this would
be... Can you put that under the camera again, just so we can see the color real nice?
Yeah.
that's a really nice color.
Yeah, so it went back. It went from the bright red of the peppers, and you added the cream, reduced it, and then it came back up to this nice bright, like, orange. Pretty sure it's orange. These glasses don't. Yeah. So I'm going to take a pretty healthy dollop of this sauce and put it in the bottom of the bowl here and kind of spread it out, because I'm going to get fancy with the presentation this week. If you, and then I'm going to put that off to the side because I don't want that to keep going. So if you want more sauce, you could always drizzle some more back over the top of your chicken. There's no rule saying that you can't do that. You just cover everything in sauce. And then I have some of this rice here, which could use a little fluffing up, but you can see that it has the nice kind of yellowy, almost, well, not yellow, but you can see that there is broth and spices added, that it's not just plain white rice. So we're gonna go ahead, and this probably isn't gonna look as nice as I want it to, but that's all right. If I was being like really super professional, I'd put the rice in a bowl and then tip the bowl over, because that's how they do it for fancy restaurants. They use like a ice cream scoop. And then we'll go ahead and we'll put the chicken around the side here. And the last thing, so it's not bad. The last thing we're gonna do is just do a little bit of a cucumber garnish, which, considering that I yet again didn't do a green vegetable.
Next time.
Next time. Yeah, sorry, Mom. We're gonna just give a couple of slices. I think in the recipe, like the picture of the recipe for Final Fantasy, I had 3 slices. So we'll just do 3 slices of cucumber. And it looks nice. So, they also put like a sprig of, no problem. They also put a sprig of something in there, which doesn't matter. It's presentation. You're going to be pulling it out of your rice anyway. So I'm not bothering with that. But yeah, so that was a pretty quick meal to cook. What did that take, like 30 minutes?
The actual cooking time was probably about 30 to 40 minutes.
Yeah.
With everything running.
Right.
With
just
you staggering things.
Right, making sure. If I was, if I had been cooking the rice, the chicken, and the sauce at the same time, it probably would have only been
30 minutes.
30 minutes.
And you could do a hot swap with tofu.
You definitely
for this
could.
Preparation.
Yes. Yeah, totally. Especially because, you know, or. There, I don't personally know the vegan alternatives to, like, the butter and stuff like that, but there's always that. You could use oil instead, too. But, yeah, tofu, if you got, like, a really nice sear on some tofu, that would be really good with this. That is something that I should try cooking more. And speaking of which, I haven't picked out which recipe we're going to be doing next week, but we were talking about this, and we do want to do a vegetarian option because, you know.
Is there a good replacement for the rice?
For the rice, you can always use riced cauliflower. That's really popular now. I've never tasted it, but I've heard it's pretty good.
If it's not specifically carbohydrates, you could always do like a risotto.
Yeah.
If you wanted to do like a small pasta.
Yeah, well, I was going to say risotto is still rice.
What's riced cauliflower looks like?
Riced cauliflower is... A lot of times you can actually just buy it in the store now, so you don't have to make it yourself. But you straight up, like, take a head of cauliflower and grind it. So it ends up coming out all shaved up. It's almost like you treat the cauliflower like you would treat a potato if you were going to make gnocchi, which is... That's getting too complicated with my explanation of what riced cauliflower is.
It's just, it's cauliflower where you've textured it down with like a cheese grater type.
Right. You texture it with a cheese grater and it's like rice.
Yeah. But it's vegetable.
Yeah. So I think that would be a perfectly fine replacement. You could replace everything, really, and still have this come out as basically being the same meal if you wanted to replace any of those things. It's really a lot. The main part of this is the pepper sauce. And, of course, you know, I used the heavy cream. You could potentially, if you didn't want to use cream, you could potentially use, like, a vegetable stock. And then it would give it a slightly different texture, but you would still be getting that same sauce type of dealy. So, low-carb options. Man, like, I feel like nothing I cook is low-carb. Sorry. Yes, quinoa. Quinoa's really tasty. And if you get just the plain quinoa, you can add whatever spices you want to it. Quinoa does take a lot longer to cook, and it's a little more finicky because you have to keep it at like a constant, you have to keep it at like a constant hard simmer because of how hard the grains are. I might cook something with quinoa one of these times, but I'm going to definitely practice that recipe a couple of times because usually when I do quinoa, I use a type that comes out of a box that has really nice instructions on it. So the not pre-packaged stuff is a little more difficult to work with. But yeah, I mean, I think that's everything. I guess this is going to be a little bit shorter of an episode today. Yeah, it's almost 10 o'clock. But yeah, thanks for hanging out. Thanks for watching me cook. And I didn't almost catch anything on fire this time with oil, so that's a plus. Make sure that you follow us on Twitter. If you're not following us here on Twitch, you should do that too, so you get the updates about when we're going to be on. Follow us on Twitter so you can also know when we're going to be on. But we're going to try to be back here same time next week, Wednesday at 8:30 Eastern, after we get our kid to bed, because that's important. And yeah, so if anybody has suggestions, things you'd like to see, I don't think I've gotten too many suggestions yet. Like, seriously, just tweet at us or yell at us anywhere that you happen to know where we are. Come to our house, tell us what you want us to cook. So I think that's it for tonight. I hope you guys enjoyed this, and I know I still don't have any of the former recipes up. I've been trying to figure out how best to format them, so this weekend I'm going to make sure I get all three of those up, the Monster Stew, the Winner Winner Chicken Dinner, and also the Dagger Quill Rice. So all three of those will be up somewhere. The best place you're probably going to find a link to them is on the 8-Bit Bites Twitter. So go get on the Twitters and do that. Okay, again, thank you. And I guess we're going to call it a night, and we'll see you next week.